Hello once again, and welcome to another edition of the SaskAgToday.com Roundtable. I'm your host, Doug Falconer, Agriculture Director at GX94 Yorkton, joined by 620 CKRM Regina AgriNews Director Ryan Young, and the Chief Agricultural Editor for SaskAgToday.com, Kevin Hursh. And first of all, I guess the big item to talk about this week was rain and spraying, and all comes back to the crop report as well. But Kevin, are people getting done their spraying right now?
Yeah, there's lots of spraying that's ongoing. I'm sure in a lot of areas it's been wet enough and windy enough that spraying is behind where producers would like it to be. Here in I'm sitting in southwest Saskatchewan, and while many areas have had decent rains and good rains and probably more rain than they want right now, we sure would welcome a rain here. There was just a light showers this week, and the crops are looking pretty good, but boy, they're gonna need a drink soon. But when you see the crop report and the amounts of moisture that have fallen in some areas, and up to 1% of cropland may not get or won't get seeded because of flooding issues, it has been a wet year in most of the province, certainly.
Ryan, of course, you and I were at Canada's Farm Show in Regina. There was some rain there on Wednesday.
Yeah, there was kind of a contrast. I believe Tuesday was kind of cloudy too, if my memory serves me right. And then the last day on Thursday, the sun was shining and it was quite warm actually. So we got a little bit of a mixed bag of everything weather-wise, and just kind of a comment on Canada's Farm Show as well. I don't know, Doug, you and I, we have kind of different interpretations when it came to the attendance. I thought the first day on Tuesday kind of had the larger crowd. You thought Wednesday was the larger crowd, but nonetheless, it was kind of disappointing in a way to see the lack of attendance at Canada's Farm Show for this year. I know talking with a lot of people, they kind of say similar things where the attendance has been declining over the last decade or so, and they're trying to, you know, find answers as to, you know, how to get that attendance back up. And one of those was actually an announcement on Tuesday that the show will be moving to March starting next year. For a long time since its inception, it's always been held in June. Kind of the rationale behind the decision was to obviously attract more people to come to the show, as well as, you know, the farm cycles change. That was another reason given. Back in the day, an example was given of farmers are done seeding right around June, so it was the perfect time to go to this event. But nowadays, with you know, the weather changing and the patterns kind of changing, that means the show has to change. So we'll see how that goes next year. I'm kind of in the camp that has its doubts as to whether it's going to work, given March is kind of unpredictable weather-wise, but I hope I'm proven wrong.
Kevin, what are your thoughts on the date change to March?
Well, it's obvious that, you know, they try to put a brave face on the shows in recent years, but obviously the change is being made for a reason, and they feel that they need to make a change. March will either be a new beginning or the beginning of the end of the show. It'll be interesting to see how it all plays out. Of course, competing with Crop Production Show in Saskatoon in January and then the Ag in Motion Show in July, and sandwiched in between those two, whether it can develop its own niche or not and be a successful show in March, we'll have to see. But there's been ongoing changes. Just, you know, it's just been the last few years when all of the outdoor displays were basically ended and everything moved inside, and they've continued like that, and now the change to March. So it will tell the tale in the next year or two whether this show indeed finds a place.
I spoke to well-known Saskatchewan farmer Sherilyn Jolly Nagel about the change in dates. She thought it would be a good idea. She believed that a lot of farmers come February, March, maybe even into April. That's when a lot of them are looking at purchasing new farm equipment and that sort of thing. So she thinks the date change will be good. What do you think of that rationale?
It's completely viable. It has, and I guess whether it's January or March, there's a lot of people taking southern holidays at that time. I don't know whether March is much worse than January, maybe a little bit worse than January in that regard. And I guess a different audience too. People that from southern prairies that might not go to Ag Days in Brandon or might not go to Crop Production Show in Saskatoon in January. It'll be a closer show for them to attend March in Regina. So perhaps it will find a place and flourish at that date.
And of course, at Canada's Farm Show as well, Ryan, you were on hand for the product unveiling that Dagelman Industries.
That's right. They unveiled their new line of HDSR Staggered Ripper. It's an introduction into Canada after a soft launch in the United States. And they've had this soft launch over the last 8 months or so. And when I was kind of talking with Derek Molnar, the director of marketing with Dagelman Industries, he was saying that this final version of the Staggered Ripper is a result of a lot of trial and error and listening to producer feedback over the last 4 or so years, trying to get this right. So, one of the things that kind of stood out to me with the Ripper was just the amount of customization that's available. It all depends on what a producer needs. There's a lot of, well, I guess I wouldn't be able to know exactly the different parts to a Staggered Ripper. It was kind of the first time hearing about such a machine in a practice for me, but since a year into this, I'm kind of learning as I go. But nonetheless, it was rather interesting to hear what he had to say about the customization and just kind of the practice of ripping in a field is becoming more common in the States. And he believes that it's going to become more common in Canada. So, yeah, looking forward to seeing how that goes in terms of its success. They're kind of taking orders for next year. They're ramping up production now. I think he said the rough number was about 100 that they're planning to make. So we'll see how that goes.
I would suspect this is a product that producers are not typically going to rip every acre every year. They're going to do headlands and compacted areas. I would see it as something where a farmer in an area might own one, or a rental company might own one, and a lot of people would use it and rent it as needed. That it won't become common on every farm by any means, but it certainly is a practice that more producers are interested in trying with large equipment and sometimes wetter fields, and believe that subsoil compaction is becoming an issue.
And I had a chance to speak with Garth Massey from Morris Equipment. They unveiled a brand new air cart. There's three different sizes, and they brought in their largest one, a 1,050 bushel air cart. It's pretty impressive. He figures the retail value will be somewhere between $400,000 and $500,000 per unit. Air carts, do you need one that big, Kevin?
That's a little over twice as big as mine is, 2.5 times bigger than mine, I guess. Previously it was called Farm Progress Show, but the show has always highlighted the biggest, some of the biggest equipment available from all of the manufacturers. And I can remember being there in the 80s and thinking, oh, nobody's ever going to want a piece of equipment that big for that job. But things have progressed and continued to get bigger and bigger. But I think the practical limits are starting to be reached as to how big equipment can be and still have it able to transport from one field to the next.
And Kevin, you also filed a couple of reports for us this week regarding, I guess, equity when it, on farms and as well as crop prices. Did you want to touch on those as well?
Interesting, the equity report from Statistics Canada. Saskatchewan led the nation with an 11.5% increase in equity as of the end of 2023 compared to the previous 1 year time frame. Assets went up across the country. Liabilities also went up, but assets went up faster and equity rose in all provinces with the exception of British Columbia. And a big part of the asset rise and therefore equity rise is increasing land prices. As far as crop prices go, Agriculture and Agri-Food Canada released its June report on the outlook for principal field crops. And one of the takeaways there is there's a real narrowing in the price spread between durum and spring wheat. Durum is usually a premium product to spring wheat, has enjoyed some strong price premiums. But if you look at the projections, durum has come down, wheat is a little bit stronger, and the price difference between durum and spring wheat in the current crop year, if you take an average of the whole year, is projected to be about $95 a ton. But for the upcoming crop year beginning August 1st, that price premium is only projected to be about $15 a ton. So a very narrow premium now for durum over spring wheat.
So, Kevin, that leads into next week's Statistics Canada seeded acreage report.
Thursday, the seeded acreage report comes out, and people always argue whether they got the numbers right or not. But as I understand it, this will be based on the actual survey of producers. And I don't think it'll be a big market mover for a crop like canola that's a big acreage crop, and the acreage will not fluctuate a huge amount compared to some of the crops like lentils or chickpeas or mustard or canary seed or even oats, where the acreage could be quite surprising and not meet or exceed expectations. And in some of those crops where Canada is a major player in the world market, that can be a market mover if acreage comes out much different than anticipated. So that's a report to watch next Thursday coming out from Statistics Canada.
Also next week will be the sod turning here in Yorkton for LDC's pea processing plant. I know at the time of the announcement, they weren't exactly forthcoming about the size of the plant, how much peas it would be processing. Hopefully, it'll be something we learn next week.
There's also an opening called Sask Valley Processors at Loreburn, Saskatchewan, next week. They do everything from pea starch to flax products to lentils to field peas to chickpeas, and don't know much about the ownership of that plant. It's first I'd really heard about it, but the grand opening is next week in the small community of Loreburn for Sask Valley Processors.
Anything on your radar for next week, Ryan?
One particular thing is I'm curious to know what the final attendance numbers were for Canada's Farm Show for this year, among other statistics. I know it was kind of mentioned in one of the news scrums you were in, Doug, that there was some deals made amongst the international visitors at Canada's Farm Show. So we might hear a little bit about how much and value of sales was made during the 3 days, as well as the attendance, like I mentioned before, and as well the economic spinoff for the city of Regina that Canada's Farm Show was on Tuesday through Thursday. So that's one thing that hopefully those numbers will come in next week.
Sounds good. Well, that'll do it for this week's edition of the SaskAgToday.com Roundtable. On behalf of Chief Agricultural Editor Kevin Hursh and 620 CKRM Regina AgriNews Director Ryan Young, I'm GX94 Agriculture Director Doug Falconer saying so long until next time.